It is now my great pleasure to introduce our 2017 commencement speaker, Mr. Austin McChord. Yeah. You'll see why. Austin is one of RIT's great young success stories. He's an alum, having earned a degree in bioinformatics. He is a successful entrepreneur, the founder, CEO, and driving force behind Datto, a privately held data collection protection company formed in 2007. As many of our students do, Austin had an idea that grew and nurtured despite the odds. Starting his company in his parents' basement, does this sound familiar? Datto is now wildly successful. It's on the coveted Inc. 500 list of the fastest growing companies for three consecutive years. Datto backs up, restores, and protects critical business data on every continent except Antarctica. What's the problem with Antarctica?
Bad internet.
It now employs more than 800 employees in locations around the world. In addition to the corporate headquarters in Norwalk, Connecticut, the company has offices in Boston, a growing presence in Rochester, Portland, Toronto, London, Sydney, and Singapore. As noted in your program, Datto is the recipient of numerous industry awards for company growth, product excellence, and technical support. Austin himself holds several patents related to virtual machines and network storage. He was named to the Forbes 30 Under 30 list in 2015 as a leader in enterprise technology, and he won the Ernst & Young Entrepreneur of the Year New York Award in 2016. As impressive as all that is, I want to spend just a minute to talk about another side of Austin. He's an alum. He embodies the innovative and entrepreneurial spirit that is RIT, and he gives back to RIT in so many ways, despite the demands of leading a billion-dollar business. He is a co-op employer and has hired 60 or 70 RIT graduates into his company upon their graduation. He's a mentor to students in the, yeah, they appreciate that, I'm sure. He's a mentor to students in the Sloan Center for Entrepreneurship and has delivered keynote addresses for the RIT Entrepreneurship Conference, the RIT 48 event, and the 2015 Venture Creations graduation event. And Datto's a title sponsor of BrickHack, for those of you who know what BrickHack is. Each year, as students graduate and enter the next phase of their lives, as you are doing this weekend, we invite them to stay involved and to contribute to the next generation of students through sharing their time, talent, knowledge, and experiences. Austin certainly took us up on that invitation and is an outstanding model of engagement with the university and encouragement and inspiration to other students. A few years back, I sent Austin an email with a link to an article where RIT was mentioned. The title of the article was, "The Next Steve Jobs is Going to Come Out of One of These 13 Surprising Schools," and of course, RIT was on the list. And I posed this question to Austin, maybe RIT already has. Austin, we are so proud to call you an RIT alum and honored to have you today as our 2007 commencement speaker. Members of the audience, please join me in giving a warm tiger welcome to Austin McChord.
Thank you. It's truly an incredible honor to have the opportunity to speak to you on your commencement today. It's been an incredibly interesting decade for me since leaving RIT. Now I warn you, I'm not Bill Nye nor Bill Clinton, both who were past RIT commencement speakers. In fact, when RIT reached out asking if I'd be willing to speak at your commencement, first thing I did is I told my friend, and her first reaction after a pause was, "I wonder who canceled." Still haven't gotten to the bottom of that. But you'll be surprised to hear that this is the first convocation I've actually ever attended, nonetheless spoken at. This kind of pomp and circumstance is rarely my kind of thing. Commencement is actually deeply ironic. On a day that's supposed to be all about you, I've been asked to spend the next 15 minutes talking about me. In trying to figure out what to say, I've tried to figure out what it must feel like to be armed with the knowledge, experience, classmates, friends, and an indiscernible future ahead of you. The best I can offer is to tell you a little bit of my story. 10 years ago, when I should have graduated with my bachelor's degree in bioinformatics, I was staring down a rockstar 2.2 GPA, no completed internships, and not enough credits to graduate. I began talking to my academic advisor about the idea of potentially starting a business, explaining that perhaps I could even co-op for myself for the summer, when in all honesty, I was worried that absolutely no one would hire me. So when I told my advisor about the idea, he made it very clear that it was not going to fly. The idea that someone could build what I wanted to do from scratch, sell it with absolutely no prior experience, and no funding was clearly not in the realm of possibility. If it was my advisor's goal in his lecture to get me to stubbornly pursue the idea anyways, then his advice could not have been more perfect. Sometimes failure can be one of the most liberating places to be. Seeing as I was already struggling with my academics, I felt there was absolutely nothing to lose in attempting to see my idea through. And I now had the incredibly powerful motivation of proving someone wrong. So I left RIT, I moved home to Connecticut, where the rent was free. I drew up a one-page business plan with the best possible case that my company would someday be worth $100,000. My thought is that I would sell it, potentially to buy a sports car, hopefully an Audi R8, the same car that Iron Man drove. That was seriously my business plan. When I tell the story at Datto, many people are surprised that I didn't have some grand vision when I created the company. In life, people say you always have to dream big to achieve big things. For me, I've realized this isn't the case. I've found that it's far better to dream often and just dream a little bit bigger than where you are today than necessarily to have some grand goal. Venturing blindly into the void is often less scary than walking the path with clear eyes. Success in business did not come easily. If I had actually known the scale of the challenges I would be facing, I surely would have never started. Early on, I learned that pretty much every investor in the world shared my academic advisor's view that I was not working on a winning idea. I ended up initially funding the company with $80,000 in credit card debt and working at a part-time job at a packaging company. When we finally completed our first product that we were ready to take to market, it contained multiple pieces of Lego and hot glue. Our secure data center was made up of some servers in a basement connected to a cable modem. I ended up using a bunch of accents to make up multiple fake employees for tech support. People would call in and I'd be like, oh yes, thank you for calling Datto, this is Peter Hedge. Or perhaps, y'all don't understand, setting these devices up isn't as easy as you think. But yeah, these fake employees subsequently made every mistake at Datto and I made none. It truly was a fake it till you make it operation. Even from the beginning though, I made a point of trying to make the office as fun and ridiculous as possible. We drove around our early office in Power Wheels cars. There was beer pong many afternoons. And while it was fun, it also helped mask the fact that in those early years, we were never more than a few weeks away from going out of business. We now continue to have fun across our offices, and our location in Connecticut has an enormous Lego wall. The British office has a pub and beer garden built into it. I converted a coworker's cube into a ball pit one afternoon. And this year, we're incredibly proud because we're able to close Six Flags for an evening for our summer party. It's been important to have fun, and we've made sure that that scales with us as we continue to grow. The crazy thing about overnight success is that it almost always takes years. One of the first times I realized that I'd actually made it came in early 2013, and this was so big it changed things forever. It was a pivotal point for Datto, and strangely, it hinges around something that I didn't do. In February 2013, a major security firm arrived and they made an offer to purchase my company. I was not expecting this at all, and they showed up with a term sheet and said that they'd like to buy my company for $100 million. This was 1,000 times greater than my original $100,000 goal. I remember clearly receiving the offer and being completely unable to keep a straight face in the meeting. This was more money than I had ever dreamed of. After the meeting, I called my lawyer and I sent him a copy of the offer. His words of advice still ring in my head today. "Austin," he said, "you could regret this decision for the rest of your life from the beach of your own private island. Sell the damn company." Naturally, I called my parents and they were unsure why I was even deliberating on what to do. For some reason, though, I just couldn't say yes. Deep down, I wasn't ready to hand over the reins to someone else. Much to the dismay of those around me, I turned the offer down. It was actually one of the most freeing days of my life. Lots of people say they love what they do, but rarely is that love tested with a 9-digit number. If you can find one thing in life, find something you truly love. It's funny because prior to this event, I had never actually stopped to consider whether or not I loved what I was doing. But in looking back and in realizing that I had the courage to turn down this offer, I realized that it was this love, this passion, that made it possible for me to run through walls, work 90-hour weeks, face insurmountable odds, and just keep going in the face of the impossible. While it clearly takes luck to be successful, I'm not sure it's possible to be successful without a love and a passion for what you're doing. Along the way, I also learned that building something great is never a solo endeavor. Getting where you are today has taken the effort and support of hundreds of people, from your parents to the numerous teachers, mentors, professors that have given you the knowledge and inspiration to earn your degrees. No matter what your interests or personality, life is a social experience. You're going to have to learn to deal with it. It took me time to realize this, and the offer I walked away from helped make that clear to me. If I had taken the offer, I would have walked away with an enormous check for myself, and those that had put their blood, sweat, and tears in by my side would have gotten nothing. Afterwards, I made it sure that everyone who works for me has shares in the company, so that if an opportunity ever came again, everyone would stand to benefit. Greed rarely builds greatness. I've learned that, sure. I've learned that taking time to recognize those that have helped you along the way is one of the most important and grounding things you can do. You truly can never be too thankful. No matter what great things you go on to do from today, don't forget those that helped you get here, and don't forget to help others in their journey. Recognition helps communicate appreciation, and supporting others in their endeavors can also communicate that appreciation and value you place on others. One of the most valuable things you will have gained from RIT will be the people that you have met. I'm sure you've heard this before, but it's absolutely worth repeating. The connections you've made here will last a lifetime. Even years forward, you'll find that you can call on the people you know now, and they will be there for you. They were part of your life at an important time. They'll prove to be invaluable, and they stand to make more of a difference in your life than perhaps anything you've learned in a classroom. Since turning down the offer around a crazy idea which my advisor knew would never work, the company has actually continued to grow. Incredibly, in 2015, just over 2 years past the offer, we made the decision to raise money. And when the venture capital firm went out to decide the value of our company, they came back and they said our business is worth $1 billion. As we've grown, I've kept a priority of making sure that we take care of the people who work at the company. So even as we get bigger, we make sure that they're taken care of. Finding a good balance is hard. The world has a way of pushing you into tracks and paths. In a few years, you may see, maybe some of your friends are buying a house, others are getting married or having kids. There's an expectation or a pressure that we're all supposed to keep up. It is important to realize this is an illusion. A sitcom family with a nice house and 2.5 kids may be what your parents have always dreamed of for you. But this life is yours and no one else's. There is no requirement that you follow anyone else's path. In looking back at my experiences since leaving RIT, honestly, I think Mark Twain said it best, and I'm going to close with a quote. 20 years from now, you'll be more disappointed by the things that you didn't do than by the ones you did. So throw off the bow lines, sail away from the safe harbor, catch the trade winds in your sails, explore, dream, and discover. Thank you and congratulations, class of 2017.
Magnificent. I think you can see by the response how people feel about that. Thank you again, Austin, for being with us today. It's truly been a pleasure to have you share this important day with our graduates and their families. And as a token of our appreciation, we also have a gift for you.
Awesome.
There you go, and you can take it out too. Yeah. It is a special place, and we take great pride in the work of our students. And this exquisite glass sculpture was created by Jake Pfeiffer, a graduate of our glass program in the School for American Crafts, College of Imaging Arts and Sciences, and you can see it has all the RIT colors as well.
Thank you.
You're the best.